Again, I invite you to turn to James 1. We shall read verse 13 to 18. Those are the verses that we're going to be considering this afternoon. James 1, 13 to 18, under the theme, "We have good God, who is our Father. Let no one say, when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. And desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death." Verse 16. "Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." This whole section has been dealing with trials and temptations. Trials, we saw, are those tests that God sends our way to help us be steadfast in faith, in order to establish us to be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. But then today, we are going to consider temptations from verse 13. And so then I ask you, what temptation are you going through in the moment? Let's take that you have no job, and you're struggling to support yourself and your family financially. Are you tempted to think that if you are dishonest, or if you steal, that the Lord will understand? In the few years that I've been a pastor here, I've seen a few people who, because of their poor or because they are sick, or because they are widows, or under any other unfortunate circumstance, they've been untruthful, dishonest, and sometimes even deceitful in order to obtain more from the deacons. So looking at your difficult situation, I would like you to be convinced from the word of God that God is very good, so that you may be sure that he will uphold you through all the challenges of life. You don't need to sin, because then if you fall into the temptation, into the snare, if you are lured and enticed and fall into that temptation of deceitfulness and dishonesty and all that, then the Lord will not be with you when you are dragged away by your evil desire. So I'm giving that to show you that there is a difference between a test and a temptation, because you need to know that there is no way you can walk with the Lord in life's trials and temptations if you live in doubt of his goodness. You need to realize that our God is good. He is good. The people that James is writing to, remember, they were persecuted Jews. And they were tempted to use their persecution that they were going through is a justification for falling into sin. Once you start thinking that your life is so difficult that the Lord will understand if you fail in other areas that you know very well that you are in a danger zone, and you still keep on going that direction, the Lord will not understand. On the other hand, there are those who may reason that, you know, God is sovereign. That's what we were considering this morning with the distinctive doctrine class. God is sovereign. And so then, if the Lord has sovereignly sent this temptation, or if he has allowed these trials to come your way so that you are now tempted, therefore God has tempted you to sin. That's the argument here. Now, that type of reasoning, it's very common. And it is one of the evidences that we are true children of Adam. We do not need our birth certificates to be indicated, son of Adam. We saw it every day. We show that we are sons of Adam by the way we conduct ourselves every day. You remember Adam? Adam did not only blame Eve for eating the forbidden fruit, he also blamed who? He blamed God himself, isn't it? How did he blame God? This woman that you, God, gave me. So if God, you had not given me this woman, I would not have eaten the forbidden fruit. So clearly, you are responsible, God, not me. That was his argument. But James, in these verses, clears God's name. He absolves God of any blame. Well, not that God needs to have his name cleared, because here James shows that God is infinitely holy, too holy to behold or to be merged with any human temptation or sin. And not only that, but also that God is infinitely good, that he only does good to his people. And so we must depend on him, we must love him, and then his promises will be ours. So the first point, I have only 3 points, and under each point I have two things to say. The first point is that God is good because he tempts no one. He doesn't tempt anyone. Now, that has an immediate implication. Don't blame God. Because we read here, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. Why? Because God cannot be tempted with evil. Get that? And God himself tempts no one. We are potty training our 2-year-old son, Gaius. So the other day, I found his trousers wet. And I asked him, Gaius, what happened? And he said that the dog did it. I reminded him that we don't own any dog. Then he responded that it was Esau's bunnies that wet his pants. Then I asked him, how did the bunny get into the house since they are in their cage and the house is locked? He said, Ruth opened up the cage for the bunnies and opened the door for the bunnies into the house to wet his pants. Now, I patiently pointed out that Ruth was in school and there was no way Ruth could have been able to open up the cage and the door for the bunnies to come in and wet his pants. So he thought, and he asked me very innocently, "Dad, do you think it could be God?" This serves to prove the little Gaius is as much a son of Adam as you and I are. Blame it on others, isn't it? Even if it's God, blame it. Blame him. Pass the buck. Keep on passing the buck. Don't let it be left with you. Now, James is telling you, stop blaming God. Stop saying that God is tempting you because he isn't. God is neither tempted with evil. That's the first thing. Nor does he tempt anyone. It is not in his nature to be tempted with evil, for he is the holy, good God. He is separated from sinners. So James appeals to the otherness of God to show that God is good. Too good to be unkind. Too good to err. So then, all attempts to blame our sins on God or to blame his sovereignty, which is the biblical doctrine of predestination, or the way he made us, you know, I'm like that, our temperaments, or our circumstances in life, or our environment, or other people, all those must be rejected. There are no more than attempts at just self-justification than when we blame it on others. Because you see, what you're doing is that you're clearing your name, and you want. You don't mind other people's names to be dragged into the muck as long as it's not me. And when God is blamed, they are blasphemies against his perfect righteousness. It's not because God made you in a certain way. It's not because God gave you this woman. It's not because God did this or the other. It's because you are the man to bear the blame. So that's the second thing I want to show you here. You are the man to bear the blame. You listen to that and say, wait, you say. Then what about the temptations that have waited all around me, all about me? Remember the picture in that Jonah gives us while he is in the fish? He said, winds were all around him. So then you're asking, from where do they come from? If it's not God, then where are all these things coming from? And then Pastor James here very wisely responds, verse 14 to 15, but each person is tempted when he is lured, when he is enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, when it is mature, brings forth death. So desire, evil desire, leading to sin, and sin leading to death. Now, in fewer words, James is saying, blame it on yourself. You are responsible. You see, we are then worse, in a sense, than Adam and Eve, who were tempted by the voice of the serpent. For the tempting voice is the voice of our own sinful nature, sinful desires, evil desires. James responds here as Nathan. Remember when Nathan went to David? And he gave this illustration. He said, there was this rich man who had thousands upon thousands of sheep and goats and all types of animals. Thousands of them. He was a rich man. And then there was his neighbor who only had one lamb, little lamb. And he used to carry it every day. And he pampered his little lamb. And when this rich man got guest to entertain, he sent for his servants to go and violently take the little lamb from the poor man who was his neighbor, and he came and slaughtered the lamb to his guest. And David thought that was outrageous. He said, who is that man? Let me know who it is right now, and he is going to be dead. What was the response? You, King David, you are the man. I suppose he swallowed his heart, didn't he? In these two verses, James nails the problem right on its head. Because the one who is blameworthy is you, not God. You are tempted when you sing the tune of your own evil desires. You're constantly hatching babies called sin. And that is why there are so many grandchildren called sin in your backyard and in your cabinet. And these little children produce death. No, sin is difficult to deal with for a lustful man who is swollen with earthly ambitions. Temptations come in the direction of your desires. And the language here is of fishing. Now, I could give you a bit of a lesson on fishing this afternoon. When you go fishing, you get hold of your fishing line, and the line is not complete without a hook, right? And the hook is not complete without a bait. And off you go. You take also a bucket of hope, isn't it? You're hoping that you will come back with some fish. That would be foolish enough to look at your bait and get into your hook and into your line, and you will drag them into the bucket. That's what you do. So off you go. The fish will look at your fishing line and it will be lured. That's a word here. It will be enticed. It will be attracted by the little poor worm that is by the hook. As soon as the bait gets into the mouth of the fish is hooked into your fishing line. And there is no choice but to drag the fish out from the water into the bucket. It's going to be dinner for tonight. That's what James is saying here. See, your evil desires, you are lured, you are enticed. And as soon as you swallow it, you know, the sin would be saying, oh, I got it. I caught him. And you land into sin, and the next thing would be that you would be in the grave, dead. So Pastor James here shows us that the life cycle of sin begins with conception of evil desires in our hearts. These evil desires then gives birth to sinful action in our lives. And finally, these sinful deeds bring death and destruction. This is the nature of the dreadful life cycle of sin. That's why you should stop blaming God, because He's good. Blame yourself. Look at your own worldliness. Look at your own fleshly passions. Look at your own youthful ambitions. Look at your covetousness and your lust. And will you be able to tame them? I can assure you that you can't tame them by blaming others or by blaming God. You can't. You remember what God told Cain in Genesis chapter 4? He was told by God, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you. That's what God told Cain. Then He told him, but you must rule over it. Genesis chapter 4 verse 7. Cain did it. And the end is that he found the grandson of his dreadful evil desires. His brother died, and he also died spiritually. You know a man called Amnon? You know him? Amnon was the firstborn son of King David. What happened? He lusted after his own sister, Tamar, and he went on to rape her. But not so long afterwards, he also kissed the grandson of evil desire, who is death. He was killed by his own brothers. These two cases then clearly show us that it's not the devil, because the devil is not even mentioned in those two illustrations given. Because our generation, or we've been trained to blame it on the devil, if it's not God, isn't it? It's all about guesswork. If it's not God, then it must be the devil. And so then, every temptation is pushed the way of the devil. Now, I'm not saying that the tempter has no role to play sometimes, but usually, and most of the times, it has nothing to do with the devil. It has all to do with your own evil ambitions. The devil, you know, is the most blamed creature on earth. And everyone wants to presuppose that the devil is omnipresent. He isn't. The devil is not omnipresent. He can only entice and lure one person at a time. So please don't overestimate the power of the evil one to entice you into sin. More often than not, it's your own fleshly ambitions. So then James very strongly warns you against blaming God in your temptations. He says, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Verse 16. And this is a warning given by a loving brother to his brethren, for he would not want his own to live in the deception of thinking that others are to blame, I am not to blame. You see, that helps you and me a lot. When we know that the temptations would bring destruction, and then we are more guarded in the way we deal with the temptations. When God says, flee sexual immorality, you don't think, I'm a mature Christian, I can master it. You immediately say, yes, if God said so, then I must do everything to guard myself against sexual immorality. When God says that we must We must resist the enemy and he will flee. Then we don't sit down for a cup of tea with the enemy. So we need to be very, very vigilant. And when you give, when you bring down the vigilance equipment, then you would immediately fall into the snare. Secondly, God is good because he gives perfect gifts. God is good because it is his nature. And this stands in sharp contrast with us, whose nature is to sin. In contrast, God can only do good and not evil. And this is true because we read here that every good and every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of light with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. And from this verse, we learn two things. First of all, God is the source of every good and every perfect gift. Do you notice how God is extremely generous in what he gives? That phrase, every good gift and every perfect gift, is not very well translated in our English translations. Because it's not just the quality of the gift, it's also in the manner of giving. That God is both good and perfect. Those are the adjectives used to refer to both the manner of giving and the quality of the gift given. So, he gives every good and every perfect gift. And he gives in the best way possible, and he gives in the most perfect way possible. It reveals that the manner of giving is good and perfect, and the gifts given are good and perfect. It also underlines the fact that good and perfect gift can only come from the good God, who is the source. Every need is fully underwritten by the endless and exactly appropriate gifts of God. Amen. James is reminding his persecuted readers of God's goodness so that in their trials they may not only realize that it is not God who is tempting them, but also that they have God on their side to endow them with all his goodness and all his perfect gifts. For God's plan is to outwork good for them. And that's why then he says, for all those who love God, those whom he has called according to his purpose, he works all things for good. That's what God has said. Romans 8:28. We must realize that the world cannot afford any good gift, and therefore it has no good to give us. That which is truly good comes from above. That's what we've read here. That is from God. Only the Father of lights, who is the creator and who is the sustainer of all creation and who is the savior of all sinners, is the source and the fountain and the spring and the constant dispenser of good and perfect gifts. When we realize that only God, only from God we have all good, then we would be more fervent in prayer. Why is God called the Father of Lights? Because from Him we have natural light. Did He not say in the beginning, let there be light, and there was light? Did He not create the elements and give them specific instructions about emitting light? Who has conveyed us from the domain of spiritual darkness into the marvelous light of His kingdom? Who? It's God, isn't it? It is God who is light, in whom there is no darkness at all, as John reports to us from 1 John 1:5. And He has made us the children of light. So He is the Father of light then. And there is no variation, no shadow of turning. So then what we receive from Him is that which is pure, that which is perfect, that which is good, because he is the Father of light. And there is no darkness in Him at all. Now, He is then the source of the good gifts that we receive. If you don't receive a good gift, then it was never from God. Because God only dispenses good and perfect gifts. And if you receive a good gift, then it's from above. It's from the Father of light. Then secondly, God is unchangeable and dependable. God only gives the perfect gifts, and He is immutably dependable. James tells us that God is the Father of light, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. We know that even if the sun gives light so consistently, yet there are times when it is obscured. There are times when it is eclipsed by the moon. There are times when the clouds would hinder the sun from emitting its light freely to us. And there are times when it's too hot for us. There are times when it is uncomfortable. That's why we ended up investing in an insulation sheet, because it was becoming an oven here. So even the sun isn't so consistent. There is no comparison between the Creator and the creation, because God does not change. That's what He says in Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. He does not change. Pink put it like this. God cannot change for the better, for He is already perfect. And being perfect, I think you can feel the rest. You following the argument? So, God cannot change for the better. Why? Because He is already perfect. Now, if He is already perfect, what's the implication? He cannot change for the worse. This glorious truth about the unchangeable nature of God, which theologians call immutability of God, presents the Lord as the most dependable, the most trustworthy, the most faithful. And this is what we sing in hymn number 104. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. You change not. Thy compassions fail not. As You've been, You will forever be. And on that basis, then we sing, great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. So God is unchangeable. God cannot change. And that means then God is always dependable. And Paul tells Timothy that even when we are faithless, he remains faithful. Why? Because he cannot deny himself. That's why. And then thirdly, God is good because he is made as his own children. Again, that's there in verse 18. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You know, this is the climax of what James says in this portion of scripture. That is, that his, this sovereign divine birth through the word of truth and being the first fruits of his creatures is the supreme example of our faithful God's gifts that we receive from him. This is speaking of God's redemptive work, and it follows the same pattern of Paul's question. He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us, how will he not with him graciously give us all things? Romans 8:32. I love that verse. Because God has given us the gift of gifts, all other gifts in one, then surely he will give us graciously all things. If being a true Christian inescapably proves to us that God is good, then there is need to be no doubting his goodness in respect of everything else he does for his people. So again, 2 points here. First of all, God has sovereignly birthed us by the word of truth. A number of things in this verse leave no doubt that James is talking about the spiritual blessing of regeneration, of salvation. In the previous verse, we've learned that God is our Father. Now we learn that this act of God is God's own initiative, for it is of his own will that he brought us forth. He was not requested, it was not solicited, he was not coerced, it was of his own sovereign will. It was out of his mere good pleasure. This sovereign work of God the Holy Spirit is what Jesus told Nicodemus about. He said, the wind blows where it wishes. You hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. John 3:8. In this passage, we are told that we've been brought forth, or in other words, we've been born again through the word of truth. Now, this phrase is the most important evidence in favor of the redemptive birth for this passage. Because the instrument through which God brings people forth, that is spiritual life, is through the instrumentation of the gospel, isn't it? It's through the word of truth. It refers to the gospel as the agent of salvation. That's how it's used elsewhere. The word of truth. If you look at you look it up, I don't have the time, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 7, or in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, or in Colossians chapter 1, verse 5, or in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, this phrase, the word of truth, is used to refer to the gospel. But we also know that being brought forth by the word of truth is not a foreign idea, that we have been born again through the word of God. That's what Peter says. You know that who gave the word of God? Who gave the word? Who gave the word? God. How did he give the word? By the Holy Spirit, isn't it? He breathed out. And we are told that men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So then Peter in 1 Peter 1 verse 23 says that we have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. This is spiritual birth by God. And it's the greatest blessing. It's the best of the blessings, of these blessings that we've read of being very good and very perfect. It's the eternal gift by which we tap into all other blessings. This is the beginning of the blessings that we have from God. So this is how then God has made us his children. Because to all who believe, to all who received him, all who believed in his name, he gave them the right to be called the children of God. He gave them the power to become the children of God. John says in John 1:12. And then lastly, God is made as the apex of his creation in redemption. But you ask, why? Why is it that God brought us forth? If you look at that verse, part B says that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Or so that, for the reason that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creation. The purpose for which God birthed us, the reason why God regenerated us, is stated in this last part of the phrase. For James says that it was with the aim of making us a kind of first fruit. Now, the ultimate purpose of all that God does in his own, is his own glory. The reason why God does all that he does is that he may be glorified. But in reaching this grand and glorious end, God has appointed the redeemed. Not just the created of the Lord, not just the image bearers, but those who've been redeemed by the blood of his Son as the first of the beings to worship him. So then when we come to church on a Sunday like this, do you know that we soil the song of the redeemed? When we sing to the Lord, we are singing along with heavenly hosts in praise of the Lord. So then the Lord has particularly appointed us to be the ones to proclaim his excellencies, because he called us from darkness into his marvelous light. Remember that as soon as the Israelites were redeemed from Egypt, when they got the other side of the Red Sea, what happened? They burst forth in praise, isn't it? And what did they say? God has cast away the rider and the chariot. How can we not? When God has redeemed us from darkness and has conveyed us into the marvelous light of his kingdom, how can you not proclaim his excellencies? So then Christians are the ones who've been made the first fruit. Now that's language of the Old Testament. What do you know about the first fruit? You remember that when they were to get to Canaan, the Israelites, and when they had cultivated and they had harvested, you remember what was to happen? What was to happen to the manna? As soon as they harvested, the manna was to cease. The manna was to stop flowing from heaven. And then they would take their first fruits where? To the temple, to the priests. Why? So that they can show thanksgiving to the Lord, but also so that they can show that God had provided for them. So what does it mean that we are God's first fruit here then? It means that we belong to God in a special way as believers. That is, we've been set apart. We've been consecrated for God's use. So he has not only owned us by the right of creation, but he has also owned us. He has possessed us by the right of redemption. And as the first fruits of all creation, we are the cream and apex of his creation. James says, God's people are his first fruit. We're the first, and we're the best of his produce. He will prove faithful. He will care for us year by year, even as he has cared for Israel in wilderness. This is what the test should teach us. If we fail, our failure teaches us to turn to God for mercy as he offers it in the gospel. And then as we persevere with him in love, come what may, we will receive the crown of life that he has promised, as we read in verse 12. So then we must acknowledge that we should be God's portion and God's treasure and a more peculiar property to him, as the first fruits were. We should become holy to the Lord as the first fruits were consecrated to him. Christ is the first fruits of Christians. Christians are the first fruits of his creatures. May the Lord help us to be the first fruits. Amen.